The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
Okay, you come on the other side. This is my favorite part. Okay.
Well, this was really, we were praying through somebody who had stolen a great deal of money from me, and a family member at that. And so Dennis had me release it as a gift to them, because nobody can steal something from you if you give it as a gift. So I was releasing from my heart, and I saw... it was like a golden, shimmering, transparent river, a glow. And what I gave with the free heart was caught up in that river, and it ascended up into the heavenlies. And then God poured out. And I saw that we can never stop the increase from our giving when we give it from our heart. However, we can stop the river by stopping to give, by failing to give, but really saw it's just amazing what is taken from earthly money and made into spiritual treasure.
Amen. Where your treasure is, that is where your heart is. It's a key indication. And some people say, I'm some people, that everybody tithes and they give offerings. It's just a question of where and who is your God. But where, ask yourself, where does it go? Because then you can even locate idolatrous relationships that perhaps need dealt with. Who knows? Right? Isn't she beautiful? Jennifer, when I met her the first year, actually before the first year, there was a period of months where I was going through a really bad place in my life. And God was in a process of really dealing with me. And I thought, and this is, God is my witness, I wouldn't exaggerate, I thought Jennifer was an angel and would disappear as soon as I got better. She had that much of an anointing on her. God spoke to me and said, this is like a Nathaniel. No guile, no trickery, no games. What you see is what you get. She don't know how to play games, and she doesn't understand why people would go so much trouble to play games. It's like, what a wasted life to play games. What do you really gain? Just what you see is what you get. And I really got a lot. I got everything I've ever wanted or needed. Next to Jesus, right? I was just, before we begin, during this time, we have people that are kind of just really knit with us by the Spirit, and whether they can explain it or not, they don't know. But I just wanted to mention a few of these people. We have someone that just feels knit with us for, now we're talking a number of years, but they're not on location, obviously. We've got Eric from Sweden, and I just want to pray a blessing, and that we corporately are going to release blessing to other people that have same, like precious faith. It's the household of God, even if they're at a distance, right? So let's bless Eric from Sweden right now in the name of the Lord Jesus. We just release that, the abundance to you, that there's loving intercession flowing out to you. Gwendolyn from Maryland has a special knitting of the heart. And then we have 5-year-old Alexander from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. By the way, he notified me, this is a 5-year-old. He is sending in his tithe and a picture for me. So we have a couple of his pictures up. And we want to also say a blessing to his mother and father, Kevin and Nicole from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. There's also our Carol, she's knit together with us from Missouri. Miguel, my spiritual son in the Bronx, keep up the good work in New York. They need it. They need Jesus just like everybody else, don't they? And Ruth in Ireland and Connie in Germany. Alita from Mobile, Alabama. And then I want to pray, too, for our prayer counselors. You know, most of our people that do prayer coaching that have been really joined to us in the spirit, they're not here on location. We have Terry that is from Bismarck, North Dakota, and she answers the phone for prayer requests. We have Barbara from Massachusetts. We've got Audrey from Virginia. Brad and Carol started a work up in Maine. Bless them. And we have a great number of Canadians that watch us on a regular basis. So just want to say hello to them and bless them. So, Father, we just extend a loving intercession that knows no distance in the Spirit. And we release blessing to them in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. I was probably, those watched by Ustream could probably even tell. I don't know. I gained about 5 pounds. And so I went to the Lord about it. I'm going, what am I doing? I usually hold pretty even, and I just gained pounds eating junk food. And those donuts, you know how those donuts, oh, we got to move this thing. Dennis is going to kill himself here. Whether it's donuts or what it is, God ended up working a message out of it. You know, that's what he does. When you inquire of him, be careful, because he's bound to speak to you. You know, you ask him questions, he's bound to answer. And so I want to pray over this, because I believe it's probably should be a couple of messages, really, if I can get through it. But God was showing me a truth that he taught me as a young Christian and is continuing. Is that my granddaughter? Nope. Yeah, you've got the granddaughter. So here's the key word. God basically was saying that what he was dealing with is a love hunger. And that when you satisfy yourself with other things, you need to return to that love hunger, that we all have a hunger and an appetite. And I was mindful of that our journey as believers is really a journey back to Father God's heart. Isn't it? We came from the Father, and we are returning to him through Jesus. No man comes to the Father but by me. But what God was basically saying is, and I used this in the last message on the four fathers, I think I did anyway, I mentioned about Oprah Winfrey, that one time I saw her on television, just one time. One time I saw her on television, and she said, how many people want to lose weight? And the whole crowd raised, how many will do whatever it takes? There's about 3 hands. Doesn't that sound like people? We would like the result, but we don't want to do whatever it takes. And what God basically showed me was that I am so glad that he took me to the school of the Spirit. I was upset when he wouldn't let me go to Bible school when I was a brand new Christian. I wanted to go instantly to Bible school. But now when I look back in hindsight, I am so grateful for that, because I did 4 Bible schools on my own later. But initially, he says, I'm going to take you to the school of the Spirit. And one of the things I learned in the school of the Spirit prevented me from falling into some of the trap that maybe some of you did. How about when you had a lustful thought? What did the church in general kind of teach you to do? Pray. Go to the Word. Huh? How many were told that? You're having bad thoughts. Go to the Word. But not necessarily did they tell you how to go to the Word. Reading is not feeding, and thinking is not drinking. And what God basically said is, I'm going to bring you into a dimension of a divine diet. And all of a sudden, all of the scriptures started surfacing. I'm saying, this is what was meant by feeding and drinking, that God called us to dine together. They that hunger and thirst for righteousness shall be what? Filled. These terms are not arbitrary. It's substitutes to what we really need, the real love hunger for God, and he made us with that appetite. You will either fill it with God, or you will basically substitutes, detours, distractions, which never satisfy that hunger. That's why we've said over the years, drink, don't think, feed, don't read. And what God had me do was that when I would open the scriptures, I did not read for quantity all the time. Sometimes you do. You know, you just read for quantity, for big picture, for total understanding. But most of the time, he would have me take a small portion until I met the author of that portion. I was not satisfied. because you met him, the living Word. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. But I was never satisfied, and that's a key word, satisfied, until I met him. And I saw that really what he taught me was that when I would be in prayer, and I was in a carpool the first year that I was saved, and my first year I was saved, second year I was saved, I was also discipling a young Harvard graduate at the same time. Amazing how much I didn't know. But he knew less, so it was good. But he would honk the horn to pick me up in front of the house. And in my prayer time, I would draw nigh to God in my heart, and he would draw nigh to me. That was an experience for me. That was not a mental scripture to quote. It was a relationship. And when it was like when I would hear him honking, I knew that I felt almost like I was being extricated from an attachment. I mean, the yearning, it almost hurt to leave his presence. Knowing that I didn't have to leave his presence, prayer was not going in and out of something, but that intimate time, it was out of that relationship. There was a glue, there was a holy union and a communion to where it's almost like, oh, if I could just stay here another hour. That's feeding and drinking. That is not thinking and reading. Your intellect will never satisfy what your heart hungers for. And it's a love relationship and it's a love hunger. And so I saw that it's the food that satisfies. And Matthew 5:6, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. They shall be satisfied. Hungering and thirsting for righteousness is basically the love relationship. It's a love hunger. Righteousness is a love hunger under the new covenant. It's love and action. It's you and him fused together into something that never existed before. And from that union, you have a life and you live that life. So it's not about what you know in your head. And so I really feel like God's saying, I want to bring a congregation into a divine diet. Maybe he used it by me kind of prodding me a little bit by gaining 5 pounds. But I'll tell you what, he basically showed me an important truth. You will fill yourself with something. If it's not food, it'll be an activity or a person. And you will try to get your need met through those things, which you basically turn them into an idol. Do you realize that? It's becoming an idol. It's replacing the love hunger for God, and it'll never satisfy. Most addictive behaviors start out that way, filling your life with something to satisfy that never satisfies. So I looked, and I just believe that God just keeps unfolding this stuff. I don't know if this needs to be two parts, because to me it's so precious. It needs to be real in our lives. It needs to be a God hunger to where you're actually touching him. Because again, what did Jesus say to the Pharisees? I'm the bread that came down from heaven. He says, you search the scriptures, and them you think you have eternal life, yet they point to me and you won't come to me. I am bread indeed. I am food indeed. This is not poetry, people. This was meant to enter into that invisible realm of the Spirit to where it became an experience for each and every one. He that has ears to hear, let him hear. He's talking about the appetite of the heart. Hearing is not these ears, but the ability to hear from the heart, the ability to absorb him. The word is him. And we have to get back to that, because otherwise we just get legalistic and full of laws and rules and regulations, when in reality he wants a love relationship which would fulfill all the law and the prophets. It won't set it aside. It fulfills. John 6:31. Our fathers ate the manna in the desert, as it is written. He gave them the bread from heaven to eat. I like it when they quote scriptures to Jesus, right? Then Jesus said to them, most assuredly I say to you, Moses did not give you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Then they said to him, Lord, give us this bread always. I just love the way people hear. And Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger. He who believes in me shall never thirst. this is not, again, it's not poetry. There has to be a dimension to where you enter into that, and you literally feed. Jesus said to them, I say to you, unless you eat my flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Now, if you go in the reasoning mind, basically he's talking cannibalism. How many know he's not talking about physically in the temporal realm eating and drinking? And yet, whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life. I will raise him up at the last day. Now, these are the words of Jesus. You can do with this what you want, but it shows me that we live too much up here and not enough in the heart. Because it says, and this is Jesus, for my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. This is the person that abides in him. So if I'm going to eat, I love one of my favorite verses when God was teaching me in the school of the Spirit, and he wouldn't let me go to formal school. I could buy all the books I wanted, and I ended up taking five Bible school courses in different camps purposely. I went to Baptist, the Kingdom, Faith Camp. I went through all of them, so Assemblies of God. I wanted to see how they related. Believe it or not, it's good to know those things, because later when I was a young pastor and I met with pastors, a lot of times there's semantical differences where they agree, but they use different terminology. I can still remember the Assemblies guy arguing with the Faith Camp guy about you. He'd go, you can't heal anybody. And the other one said, yes, you can. And I'm going, wait a minute, guys. You're arguing over the word you. In the Faith Camp, you was your recreated human spirit, the new creation you. Assemblies, when he heard you, he meant your flesh. So you got one guy saying, you can't heal anybody in your flesh. And the other one's going, yes, you can in your recreated human spirit. And they're arguing over the word you, all based on how they learned it. All right? Now, there is obviously differences in the body of Christ, but there's a whole lot of that if you live up here, you're going to get stuck. We're to know one another by the Spirit, and we're to know God by the Spirit. And I'll tell you what, it'll answer a lot of questions. So, God basically says, so he who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me. There must be something beyond reading that enters into feeding. There must be something beyond thinking that cultivates into drinking. Are you with me so far? Scripture's loaded from Old to New Testament. It's loaded on this, but we need the application to make the distinctive difference. I can remember people saying, I was struggling in my thought life, so I went to the Word, and they just started reading arbitrarily. All that is a detour. You need to go to Him, not to an activity. And many people have struggled with their thought life. They've struggled with their thing because they went to an activity. From one activity to the other, that's just basically called behavior modification. Isn't it, Jennifer, similar? You just change one. I don't get drunk anymore. I just eat jelly beans all day long until I have a sugar attack. You know, one's a little more socially acceptable. But one, you just went from one addiction to another addiction. And God's basically saying, and when he... when he really gave me the solution as to how do I deal with this stuff, how do I enter into that feeding on you instead of just reading? How do I enter into the Word of God to where I meet the author, to where it's a person, to where the Holy Spirit himself makes himself real and it becomes substance that satisfies, because you're telling me the other doesn't satisfy. I want what satisfies. In other words, I want what fills that love hunger that you put in me from the beginning. And God basically says, Jeremiah 2:13, my people have committed two evils. What are those two evils? They've forsaken me, the fountain. And they put a substitute. They made cisterns. They found a substitute. There's no vacuum in your life. Wherever God is not, there is a substitute. The trouble is, the substitute doesn't satisfy and can impact your life. My people have committed two evils. They've forsaken me, the fountain of living water. What kind of water? Living water. Would that satisfy your thirst in a spiritual context? Of course it would. But they've hewn for themselves cisterns, broken cisterns that can't even hold water. At best, it's like drinking out of a bird bath. That's really what your substitutes are compared to the excellency of living water. Remember John 7:39? On that last day of the great feast, by the way, what they were doing on the day of the feast is they had like a silver sieve that would have little holes in it, like your colander or something like that would have, and they would pour water into it, and it would flow out in rivers. And Jesus stood up and cried and said, if anyone truly thirsts, let him come unto me and drink, for out of his belly will flow rivers of living water. Isn't that a little better picture of ritual? Ritual compared to I'm the real thing. I'm the living water. If you come to me and drink. Didn't he tell that to the woman at the well as well? Saying, you drink this water, you're going to thirst again. I'm going to give you water that you'll never thirst again. And I believe that this is what God's doing. Whoever drinks of this water will thirst again, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give them will never thirst, never thirst, never hunger. There's got to be a key here where we quit just reading and thinking and start feeding and drinking. And you have the capacity to do that. But there's also an awareness by God that believers can fall into the category of the soils. How many know that the soils has to do with a hearing heart? A hearing heart is a heart that knows how to drink and feed. And it's various less. Some will produce, some are hard. Some will stay in the intellect and just reason. Others will absorb and produce 100-fold. It's the tenderness of the heart. Take heed how you hear. With the measure you use, it'll be measured to you. You might as well say, take heed how that hearing heart feeds. Some people heard what Jesus said. Do you think Jesus was anointed? And there's people that heard him and did nothing with it. So you can't blame Jesus' anointing that they did nothing with it. It was how they heard. All through the scripture, especially in the book of Revelation, he that has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Because it's supposed to be food indeed, and it's supposed to be drink indeed. It's supposed to be living word. It's supposed to be Jesus. Now, as God was teaching me this in the school of the Spirit, I would hear my friends say, oh, I just got to go to the Word. I'm struggling with my thought life. Go to the Word. And what I was doing was, in my prayer time, I found Jeremiah 15:16. Jeremiah 15:16 said, your words were found, and I did eat them. It still has as much life today as it had 40 years ago. Your words were found, and I did eat. And it was unto me the joy and the rejoicing of my heart. If that doesn't happen, you're not feeding or drinking. You're just reading and thinking. Your word was found, and it was unto me the joy and the rejoicing of my heart. Old Covenant David, right? David, Psalm 19. He started talking about your statutes are right. Rejoicing the heart. Your commandments enlighten the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean. The judgments are true and righteous. Sweeter than the honeycomb. I don't believe he was just doing poetry. He found statutes and the fear of the Lord and all of these things that you could go into legalism over. He found them as the things that enlighten us, sweeter than the honeycomb. Your word was found and I did eat, and it was unto me the joy and the rejoicing of the heart. The church needs to be challenged back to intimacy with God, because all your head learning isn't accomplishing anything. Going to be just like that day. I knew you not. Well, didn't I move in the gifts? Didn't I move that? You know what? Anybody could. A baby Christian full of sin could move in the gifts of the Spirit. So don't look at it as some kind of a badge of accomplishment. God's basically saying, I want that relationship, and I want the walls to come down. And I think what Jesus is basically saying in the natural, if you're extremely hungry in the natural, you make finding food a priority, don't you? I mean, if you're really hungry. I saw an old movie with who was that guy with the bright blue eyes? Paul Newman? Yeah. Paul Newman was playing in some kind of a Western, and a woman was real pristine, sophisticated from the East, not used to the West. And she said, I hear these Indians are savages. I hear they'll even eat dog. And he just looked up. This is in a stagecoach. And he just looked up for her with those piercing blue eyes and looked at her, and he said, lady, if you are ever really hungry, I don't mean just moving away from your tea and crumpets during lunch. I mean really hungry. You'd eat dog and you'd fight for the bones. Whoa. I'll tell you what, most people don't even know what hunger is. But if you were hungry, you would make it your priority. And it would taste good, stuff that normally you didn't care about. Huh? When you're extremely hungry, you make finding food, and it's the same way that we have to really tap into that hunger for God. It's got to be a priority. If it's not a priority, you will fill your life with stuff that doesn't satisfy. We're supposed to be doing this in church, actually. I'm as guilty as the next pastor. I try to impose certain things, but you can impose. You can't really make anybody do anything, right? You can lead a horse to water, but you can't make it drink, and that's not in the Bible, but it's true, right? But we're so prone to teaching when we should be encountering God, feasting and drinking. That's why I actually like it when I see some people during worship just drinking in. Sometimes you've had a hard work. Yes, worship is the giving out and a releasing, but it's two ways. It's giving and receiving. I've seen people, even in my first pastorate, if I was to preach, God told me, you only preach what's real to you. Don't preach secondhand information. If it's not real to you, stay away from it. And so that's probably why I don't preach a whole lot of eschatology. It's not very real to me. I'm more concerned with growing up than going up, all right? But it was like people would close their eyes and they were drinking in and feeding more on the substance of the preaching of the word than the actual, what are you actually saying? Have you ever done that? If you've ever done it, it's healthy. Have you ever listened to a worship song where it wasn't so much the lyrics as much as you were drinking in the anointing? You were feeding, not thinking. You can sing and you can worship, and it's two different things. One's basically coming out of that communion and out of that relationship, out of that expression of that relationship. But I think that there's a lot of people, their relationship has got to remove the barrier, and for the love hunger to increase, you're going to have to locate what you've been feeding on. You are what you eat, right? That's what they say. And I believe that God's basically speaking a divine diet, that we're to pursue a divine diet to satisfy that God hunger, that love hunger that he's made within all of us. Psalm 36, verse 8, feast on the abundance of the king's house, and the Lord gives us drink from his river of delights. When you tap into the river of God, you don't live in condemnation, you live in the delight. It's a river. Even the will of God is a river. The will of God should be a delight. The will of God should be his goodness. Feasting and drinking. I just find it so amazing that the scripture is so loaded with it, and yet we have surrendered. Even the Pharisees surrendered to scholarship over relationship. Psalm 107, hungry and thirsty, their soul fainted in them. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them out of their distress. He satisfies the longing soul, and he fills the hungry with goodness. So there was a natural hunger, and they cried out to God. But when God satisfies the longing soul, he fills the hungry with goodness. God promises to fill the hungry and give drink to those that thirst. It should be feasting and drinking. I like this. The book of Revelation, chapter 1. And quite frankly, my theology has always been, and I know everybody loves to teach on Revelation, mine was it's a revelation of Jesus. Pure and simple. The revelation of Jesus Christ is a revelation of Jesus, that you might know him by the Spirit and that you would know him in all of the attributes that he's displaying. And chapter 1 in the book basically reveals who Jesus is. The first chapter in the book of Revelation, it's the proper grounding for the church, the foundation. The Apostle John, who was exiled in Patmos, was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. And in chapter 1, he hears a voice of the sound of many waters. telling him to write what he sees. The Lord stands in the middle of the seven golden lampstands, which is a picture of Christ in the midst of his church. In his hand are seven stars. Two-edged sword comes out of his mouth. The seven stars are the angels or the messengers of the seven churches. He is the light of the world, and his assemblies are light bearers. Jesus reveals himself as the Ancient of Days in his appearance and position, describing his character and his attributes and his supremacy as Lord, divine judge, and redeemer. He calls himself the Alpha and the Omega, who exists in eternity outside of time as we know it. And so I see the beauty of this is that if the first chapter reveals Jesus, the second and the third chapter talks about feasting on him. How come we overlook that? How come we just think it's always poetry? Why don't we say, I need that kind of relationship? In chapter 2 and 3, the Lord emphasized to the churches, they were designed for eating and drinking Christ as spiritual food. You were designed for eating and drinking Christ as spiritual food. Listen, he says, and this is unfortunate, and we're all as guilty as the next, but churches are not primarily places for teaching. They're places to feast on Christ himself. He's the tree of life and the hidden manna. So in our worship, it's not about singing songs. It's about meeting him and experiencing his presence and knowing that while you're experiencing it, you absorb and become a partaker of that divine nature. You're actually feeding upon him. And I am so grateful that I didn't have that early teaching where you just go to the word and read when you're troubled. Just read when you're troubled. And, you know, just read. I've seen a lot of people frustrated by that. And it hasn't brought necessarily sanctification because they didn't enter into the depth of the person of the Lord Jesus in it. They merely substituted, my people have committed two evils, forsaken me the fountain, and they just started drinking. They started finding a substitute. They found appetites. You know what? There's going to be people, if you have eating disorders, you're going to get ministered to on this day. I really believe that. I mean, you can feed on all the wrong things, person, places, or things. But I want to tell you something. It's phenomenal that a lot of eating disorders basically is rooted in an addiction to not satisfy. You're trying to satisfy something that cannot be satisfied. You can either be anorexic or you can go the other way and just feed. You can do it for all the wrong reasons, but there is a need that Jesus could meet inside. It's a love hunger. There's the real need, and if you don't meet that, you're going to find a substitute. My people have committed two evils. They've forsaken me, the fountain, and they've hewn for themselves cisterns for drinking and eating. They're going to fill it because there's no voids. So when we come together as a local church, we should be feeding upon Christ, drinking in the substance that's on that teaching, not just the teaching. Experience true satisfaction. You should feel filled and full and that I've been fed. Isn't that something? In churches, we're to be fed. That doesn't mean just teaching. That meant substance. It should be entering in and bringing a satisfaction on the inside of me that I've been a partaker. In hungering and thirsting after him, I've been a partaker of the divine nature. In other words, there's been a deposit left within me. I've got something now that I didn't have when I came in, and I'm going out with more and more of him replacing my flesh. Interesting. We should be gathering to encounter God, and God, and this is particularly true in the book of Revelations to all the churches, which applies to us, does it not? He invited them to come and dine. Why is all this terminology in there? It's not a coincidence, and it's not just poetic poetry to make it sound nice. He really wanted us to feast and encounter. I bet you he lost some disciples, didn't he? When he said, unless you drink my blood and eat my flesh. That probably thinned out the ranks a little bit. Because we're so concrete in our thinking, we miss spiritual truth. I'm telling you what, I know that God taught me this. He taught me this at the time when I was a baby. I saw it in Psalm 19, sweeter than the honeycomb, but that your words were found, and I did eat them, and they were unto me the joy and the rejoicing of my heart. If you don't have that as an experience, you've got an intimacy problem. You've got a distance problem. You've got a feeding problem. You've got an eating disorder. Is that possible? If that scripture makes no sense to you, you've not met him. You're still drinking of the water that you're going to thirst again, and you're still feeding on something that's never going to satisfy your appetite. Your word was found, and I did eat, and it was unto me the joy and the rejoicing of my heart. I'm telling you, in the second and third chapter, the emphasis again on Book of Revelations is on eating from the tree of life in Ephesus. He's promising to eat of the tree of life. That's the kind where you never hunger again and you're satisfied, and it's the kind you never thirst again because it's eternal food. Revelations 2:7, in the second and third chapters, the emphasis shifts to eating from the tree of life in the church of Ephesus. And the third church, or Pergamos, it's promised the hidden manna. Can you people hear food? Do you hear food in any of this? Do you hear feasting in any of this? Hidden manna is promised. Who's this promised to? This is the person that's pursuing him. This is the person that there's a criteria. Most of this stuff, deep truth can God, that is really satisfied and really becomes a partaker of that divine nature, can go over a lot of people's heads. Because information will not communicate it. It's relationship. And if you don't own it, you cannot give it. And if you don't receive or know how to receive, you aren't going to get it either. The banqueting table is with the king. I stand at the door and knock. How many times have you heard this? You've heard it in evangelical circles to win people to the Lord. If anyone hears my voice and opens, I will come in to him and dine with him and he with me. What does that mean? Is that just some more poetry? Is it just all about food and drink? Or is there a spiritual relationship that is absent? I'm saying if you hear, the implication is not everybody hears. And you know what he taught me when I was going through this? Your word was found. He said, Dennis, I'm going to wake you. Isaiah 50 was my training chapter. Isaiah 50 says, I'm going to awaken you morning by morning. Morning by morning, I'm going to awaken your ear to hear. That means I'm going to, you position yourself, I will awaken my ear. And I'm not revealing myself to just anybody. I'm revealing myself to those who love me. Those who have a hunger for me, those who have increased appetite, because there are plenty of people that can read about me and really know not much at all. I'm going to awaken you morning by morning. I'm going to awaken. That means I'm going to quicken. I'm going to incite the action. I'm going to create an appetite for you to be a partaker of the divine nature. And you're going to be, when I draw nigh to God, he's not in heaven. When I draw nigh to God, I draw nigh to him here, and he draws nigh to me. And I'll tell you what, even when your five senses pull you away, like donuts, which I've had my share of this week, that's where the 5 pounds came from. Donuts, your five senses draw. But when you go to him, you draw nigh to him, he draws nigh to you. And it's amazing how magnetic and how powerful you can overcome all of the appetites. By the presence of God. He's not wimpy. It's just a question of your hunger and your thirst for him. Your word was found, and I did eat, and it was unto me the joy and the rejoicing of my heart. Your judgments, your commandments, your statutes. Doesn't that sound like a bunch of law? Your statutes, your commandments, your judgments, sweeter than the honey and the honeycomb. You have to enter into that experientially, or that doesn't make sense. To the reasoning mind, that's a bunch of legal laws, rules, and regulations. I want to mess with the people who do have and do use eating, either overeating or undereating, anorexic, bulimic, or just pigging out, all right? You're satisfying a love hunger, and you're overcompensating even with food. I found 12 common reasons 12 common reasons for compulsive eating, and you're not going to be able to write these down. You're going to have to watch it over and over and over again. I got your attention, though, now, huh? See, when you touch on their flesh, you get their attention. You give spiritual truth, and it's like, I don't know what I'm talking about. All right. Cultural pressure. Do you think we have any cultural pressure to eat certain kinds of foods? Did you know that it was a group of marketers that promoted bacon and eggs as the ideal breakfast in America until it was pretty commonplace? They did that through advertising. How about McDonald's? You deserve a break today. You need to get away. Nothing like appealing to your lower nature. You deserve. Boy, we like that. We deserve. Oh, I deserve a break today. I need to get away. Huh? How about, here's another one. You know when some people eat? They hide subconsciously from intimacy, and this is my concern for the church. I'm saying you're eating and drinking food, activities, people, codependent relationships, because you're actually afraid of intimacy. You know the saddest thing about a codependent relationship is someone will be trying to rescue someone who cannot ever give back. And their mission is to save them, rescue them, and redeem them, and they don't want to ever give back in that relationship, and they find a cycle in there, but it never satisfies. It's a love hunger misapplied with a substitute. My people committed two evils. They've forsaken me, the fountain, and they've hewn for themselves a substitute. And it becomes a relationship addict. Subconscious hiding from intimacy. And by the way, then you don't ever have to deal with your intimacy because you're so busy trying to rescue somebody and redeeming somebody, and they don't give back in the relationship except your need to be needed. That's not a real relationship. Then there's the need for immediate gratification. I remember when they tested little kids with marshmallows. And some of the kids that were able to refrain from instant gratification, when they found them 10 years later in the study, they found they were successful. People that are successful are people who can delay instant gratification. But they had these little kids in there, and they gave marshmallows. And then they were on camera, but then the instructor would say, now, if you can eat that right away, or you can wait till I come back and you get two more. And then the teacher would walk away, and one kid went, couldn't wait. Forget the two more. I got it here. I want it now. Instant gratification. Another kid was moaning and groaning because he was going, he would just lick it. He wanted the two more, but it was killing him. And then they found the ones that actually waited, and it was quite a while that the teacher was gone, then came back in the room, actually waited, and they got the double. They said when they checked those kids' lives out later on, the ones that were able to deny instant gratification were the most successful in life. You know, you pay a price to succeed and to achieve things, right? It's not always easy street, and the world doesn't owe you a living. In my generation, I'm old enough to remember J. Edgar Hoover. He said, the definition of a juvenile delinquent is one who thinks society owes them a living. And now we live in a whole generation where, oh, I don't have a problem with not working. The government pays me. I don't have a problem with that. I'm comfortable with that. I'm comfortable living off of other people's money. That's what they're saying. I don't need to get a job. I'm comfortable with that. All right, here's another one. The need for immediate gratification. How about using food as a tranquilizer? I can remember when I was a little kid, my mom and dad, they worked nights, and they both worked, and they were out of the home a lot, and they used to pride Dennis in the fact that he could take care of his two younger sisters, and he was only, I don't know, 8 or 9 years old, and he could take care of his two younger sisters. He is so mature. But I hated being alone. And what I would do is I'd go into the cupboard, I'd eat cereal, I'd take a box of cereal and eat the whole box. It was like satisfying, I have a need, that need is not being met, and that's the way I coped. So I basically rewarded myself by eating. It was almost like a tranquilizer or some kind of a compensation. Some people focus on food to avoid basically facing problems. Oh, did you fall down, Dennis, off your bicycle? Here, have an ice cream cone. It'll make you feel so much better. Sometimes we were taught that, right? Using food to punish themselves or others. Over the years of ministering to people, I knew people that purposely gained weight so that they would not be attractive to men, ladies in particular. I thought it was kind of unusual, but I saw it so many times, there has to be some truth to it. What were they doing? The fear of intimacy. Using food relieves depression or stress. So it can be like a drug. Expressing a need to control circumstances. There's always control, anorexic, bulimia, or overeating. It's all a control issue. Faulty perception of your body image. Emotional feelings about food developed at the parents' dinner table. Okay, moms and dad, listen. Could be you finish everything on your plate. That could set a pattern. Eat it whether you like it or not. Some even say withholding sweets and things from your children will create in them later on an addiction to want it, to compensate for those years. So be wise in some of these ideas that you have. And besides, if you wait till you're my age, you'll find out that those so-called rules of nutrition change every 5 years. What was locked in as a honest-to-goodness truth gets changed later on, so nutritionists are not necessarily your experts. Using food as a nurturer to satisfy the love hunger is where I'm trying to go with this. So the food you put in the stomach. I want that one slide. We had just that one slide of the belly and the heart. I just love this. Those of you, can you see this? This would sum up the whole message in a nutshell. Clearly, that's a stomach on the right, and that's your Bible heart on the left. An empty heart and an empty stomach. No matter what you put into your stomach, you're going to remember this. See that picture? Burn it right there. No matter what you put in your stomach never satisfies your heart. No matter what person or activity that you eat and drink of is not going to satisfy the heart. Only Jesus. Only Jesus. You can't just say, oh, if I just had a man, if I just had a woman, I'd be happy. Oh, if I just had kids, I'd be happy. Talk to someone who has them first. We love the children. They know I'm joking, don't they? All right, they got scared. They look scared. All right. But the food we put in our stomach never reaches our heart to satisfy. I mean, really, if we really took that to heart, you've got activities, relationships, activities, not just food, activities that you use instead of intimacy with God, and it won't satisfy. It will appear to satisfy for a season. Actually, let's go to the, I am going to do the next one. I want you to see the cycle. Let me do the next one. Look at that. Look at love, hunger. There's a need. And we were created with needs, all of us. There's this internal need, and it can be filled righteously by our relationship with Jesus. But instead, we're feeling uncomfortable. Me as a kid, I was lonely, so I'd go eat in the cupboard everything that was in there just to make me feel good. That's playing God. And it's finding an idolatrous substitute rather than finding in that relationship true satisfaction. He is my exceedingly great reward. All right? The emotional pain leads to what? An addiction. In other words, if you do it one time, you're more than likely you're going to do it two times. If you do it two times, you're going to do it three times. After a while, you've got a habit. You may not even call it an addiction, but it's a habit. And it's a habit of meeting a need without using Jesus. And what happens? You gain 5 pounds. This is personal. This I'm preaching to me now. You gain 5 pounds. That's number four. That's the consequence. So I have a love hunger that God could satisfy my appetites and bring moderation into the appetites. But no, I think that I think donuts. Yes, donuts. And what does it do? It calms that emotional pain. It feels good, at least while you're eating it. Then while you're eating it, you begin to use that as, I'm just going to have another donut. And the next time that I have a need, you need one, you need two. Then you need different kind. That's the way addiction works. You need different kind. You need more of. Then I got this habit now. The trouble is, there's a consequence. I'm gaining weight. I'm wearing those donuts, one on each hip now. Oh, then we go into this, and this is where most church people go. Number five, guilt and shame. Ooh, that feels so bad. I shouldn't have ate the whole thing. Does that sound like anybody? You ever done this? Am I the only one? Oh, I shouldn't have done it. Oh, why did I do that? Well, Jesus died for your guilt and your shame. But if you don't deal with the guilt and the shame, guess what you do? I hate myself. And once you start hating yourself, you're going to need love. And so how do you get your love? Well, give me a whole box of donuts. Right? Is this the way you solve self-hatred? I think I would rather feast on Jesus because this really doesn't work. And it goes in a circle, what we call cycles, which we call habits. I want to break free from that. I should be 5 pounds lighter by next week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks. I'm not making any promises. Okay. But here's the idea. When you blow it, instead of getting legalistic, when you have a relapse or you make a mistake, you don't lose the whole war. I've seen people make quality growth in their Christian walk when I would simply use an illustration that, oh, so you fell back a step. You didn't fall all the way down the steps. It's like 2 steps forward, 1 step back. But you know what? That's the way I learned most of the stuff where I made progress. I made progress, and then I didn't make progress. And then I made more progress. And you're moving forward and upward like a stairwell. So don't beat yourself with self-hatred because you fell down a step. Get back up, learn from it, and do what's right. As a matter of fact, God used Micah chapter 7 to train me that. He was training my spirit to say that basically when a righteous man falls, he gets back up. That's the advantage we have as the righteousness of God in Christ, is you can fall, but a righteous man gets back up. There's hope. The unsaved or the wicked fall, and they're down for the count. And they are without God, without hope, without a covenant, without promises. You're not made that way. You're made that you can make a mistake, but you can redeem it, learn from it, and actually cause it to become a truth that will be part of your life from that time on, so that you don't do it again. When you blow it, you need to take inventory. Today, I believe if you're watching by Ustream, and if you're in this building right now, you need to make an inventory of your emotional and relational issues that led to some of your problematic behaviors, some of your downfalls, some of your slips. Because there was a hunger. You know, I once was training in a course on sex addicts. And sex addicts had a little formula that I just fell in love with. I said, this really works. They called it the HALT principle. You know, HALT means stop. H-A-L-T. And it said to move into a sanctified recovery, a spiritual recovery, a transition, don't ever position yourself to be too hungry, too angry, too lonely, or too tired, because you're vulnerable. So watch yourself. If you're going to mess up, you'll mess up when you're too hungry, too angry, too lonely, or too tired. Halt. hungry, angry, lonely, tired. You can remember that. But it's a handy thing, because if you see yourself, that's the time to be careful. Guard your heart, for out of it flow the issues of life. That's the time to be careful for that. Love hunger. Never get too hungry, angry, lonely, or tired. The love-hungry cycle, right there, you can live in that forever, or you can, but also when you live in this, you're also saying, you're also on the other end of God's rebuke of Jeremiah 2:13, where he says, my people have committed two sins. They've forsaken me, the fountain, and they found a substitute. What is your substitute? How do you deal with your emotional pain? And there's a lot of angry people that don't know why they're angry. They think they're angry at God, the church, whatever. But in reality, it's because you've been feeding on something and you need a divine diet. Your diet is not divine. You might be biblically literate, but you're not dining on him. It is not a relationship with him. You have intimacy issues. And I believe to make ready a people prepared for what God is calling, there's a turning of the hearts to the fathers to the children to the fathers, that you need intimacy. Fathers to children, children to father, that's talking about relationship. It's talking about spirit to spirit, not head to head. It's talking about relating. And until we get there, did I not prophesy, did I not cast out devils? Depart from me, I knew you not. You work lawlessness. You're operating in your own system. You have your own box. And the whole purpose of what God was saying is, I am the God who operates outside of that box. And it has dominion on that box. So you can make all your own little judgments, your own little world, your own little thought processes. But however, mine is what affects you. And I strongly suggest, if you didn't hear last week, you need to go back and see the four fathers and find out who is your father. Because you've got four of them. Should have an awareness of who's who. There's four fathers, and you don't want the devil. How many can identify any unmet needs? Can you? We should be praying this. Here's the way the Lord taught it to me, and we made a diagram out of it, but for me it was a relationship, not a diagram. Can we put that last one up? We have this in some of our training manuals now, but I learned that experientially. The inworking and the outworking of the word becoming flesh, or becoming a part of feasting and drinking and dining with Jesus. That looks like a rigid little chart, but for me, I'm just defining how my relationship worked. I would make inward and outward discipline. I have to start with a choice. Are you going to pray this morning, Dennis? That's just mental. Yes, I am. So, it was an inward desire to meet him, because until I meet him, I can't absorb nutrient. I can't absorb him as food or drink. I have to meet him first. I can't just think him. I can't just read about him. I must meet him, or you cannot absorb the reality. Then what God showed me was that while I was absorbing, I noticed there was an attitude adjustment. The attitude was the work of the cross. And God was saying, it's not positive or negative, Dennis. What it is, it's the attitude of the cross. And that all of a sudden, a forgiveness became natural. I receive forgiveness, I release forgiveness, and the food went in better because I was cleansing the heart. So the attitude, he was birthing an attitude. How many think you need an attitude birthed? I'm not talking about mental attitude. I'm talking about the disposition of the heart, where your heart is. That's where your treasure is. Where your treasure is, that's where your heart is. The heart of the matter is the matters of the heart. It isn't about your head. And I saw that birthing of an attitude produced that I was now a partaker of the divine nature. In other words, I could feel Jesus in that word. I knew him. If it was a shepherd, I knew him. I could feel his comfort. I could feel his care. I really believed it. I didn't just think it. I believed that Jesus cared and loved me, and I could feel the comfort of it. So I met him. I was a partaker of that divine nature. And now my value system is him, not were ink on a page. Now it was, I know the shepherd. The shepherd is my comfort, my security, my safety. And even though I walk in the valley of the shadow of death, I don't fear any evil. I don't fear much of anything. Neither does Jennifer after the first year we were married, right? That was the first thing she dealt with. And I've seen her fearless for 20 years. You don't have to live in there. That's the wrong kingdom. But you need your value system not to be rules and regulations. Your value system needs to be Jesus, him in reality. He is truth, but he is reality. Then I saw, if this is the way you feed and drink, then how do I live? Isn't feeding and drinking to give you strength to function? The outworking of it was that I was coming out of a value system that I was God confident based on my feeding and drinking. I was God confident, not self-confident, and that I maintained that connection by either praying in the Spirit or walking in forgiveness. It keeps you in the love of God, praying in the Spirit. Bishop Hammond's got a book, 66 Reasons Why You Should Pray in Tongues. And some of you quit doing it because you got sophisticated. All right. Praying in the Spirit and walking in a forgiveness lifestyle, you maintain that relationship, and that relationship gets stronger and stronger, and that's the way you live. You live like that. Attitude. You know what happens then? You're grateful. Remember, you birthing an attitude, but I'm telling you what, when it's really him, there's an attitude of gratitude. All of a sudden, the will of God is good. All of a sudden, the will of God is not interpreted as drudgery. The will of God is pleasure. How many people interpret the will of God as pleasure? I know a lot of people afraid of the will of God, afraid of what he might make me do. That's religion. It should be his pleasure. I delight to do his will. That was Jesus' attitude. It was a pleasure to do the will. That attitude becomes better than a positive attitude. It becomes a work of the, it becomes the character. An attitude becomes a love motivation. Suddenly now you're moving more by the motivation that God is in you. And your behavior, your outlook on life is redemptive orientation. You're always looking for a solution. Regardless of the dirt, you're looking for the gold. Now, a lot of people might say, oh, that's too complicated. I'm doing the best I can to explain what was a relationship to me, the way it worked, and I know it worked, and that's the way it came out. So that's the best you can do it. If you did that just by the reasoning mind, it probably wouldn't mean a thing, because it has to be relationship, 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 or that means nothing. I want to pray that if you've got cisterns, and it could be people in your life, it could be appetites, food, and others, it could be activities, work and entertainment. Do you believe you can make an idol out of work and entertainment? Some people use work and entertainment to avoid relationship. Some are hiding behind walls of fear, and so they get busy with either people or various appetites. I know it breaks my heart. I see some people that I'm saying the potential was there, but I could never get to the gold because they had this activity thing that they had to do, but they were like a hamster in a hamster wheel. They were really going nowhere, but they were busy, very, very busy, because they were hiding in that activity, in those things that were going to make them happy. But I haven't seen them happy yet. I'm talking about people known for 10, 20 years. They're still not happy. They're still searching. They're still looking for that something that's going to make me happy. And it's a love hunger. And God's the only one that can satisfy that. Why don't you come to him? You say you're a Christian. You search the scriptures. And then you think you have eternal life. And yet you won't come to him. It needs to be a relationship. Let's pray for that right now. And if you're watching by Ustream or what have you, I want you to pray with this too. How many have identified people or appetites or activities? Raise up your hand, don't be ashamed. I see something that I hide in. I need delivered from that. And in order to deliver that, I receive the gift of forgiveness and the gift of repentance that I've been feeding that for a long time. I think I'm going to go on a divine diet. I'm going to go on a divine diet by saying that I'm going to release that demand and expectation to do that. You have to realize it first. I realize that that thing has been consuming me. I receive forgiveness and the gift of repentance that I might do otherwise. And God, when I see even the temptation for that same old activity, same old food, same old habit, same old appetite, I'm going to drop down into my spirit and feed upon Jesus instead. I don't want a substitute. I want the real thing. Your word was found, and I did eat, and it was unto me the joy and the rejoicing of my heart. I want it to be an experience. I want to hunger and thirst after righteousness. I want to drink from the fountain of the living water. I want to feed on the tree of life within. I want reality. I want substance, not shadow. I don't want the shadows of religion. I want the substance of Him and the reality of His presence. Let's just welcome that time right now. And you know what else we needed to do? The church added it many decades later. But when I was a baby Christian, it's what the world calls soaking. That's a rather new term. It wasn't new to me. That's the way I prayed. I would soak. Soaking was drinking. Soaking was feeding. And I would feed with specificity based on what the word was coming to me at that point in time. Whatever scripture God was quickening, I soaked in it. I absorbed it. I became a partaker. It's time to feast, church. It's time to encounter Him in our worship and in our times alone. We need to find appetites that are distractions, detours, and basically say, I'm going to drop down and I'm going to have Him as my exceedingly great reward. I'm going to have food that you know not of. I'm going to start doing the will of God from the heart. I'm going to start feeding on delight. I'm going to start feeding on His goodness and on His pleasantness. And I am mindful that when I was filled with the Holy Spirit and had an open vision, and I looked down at a living Bible and the words came off the page, it's for such a time as this. That was 40 years ago, but Hosea 3:5 in the living Bible came off the page in the air, and it says, afterward, after you've done away with your idols and your appetites and your false activities and your substitutes, afterwards, they will return to the Lord their God and to the Messiah their King, and they shall come trembling and submissive to the Lord and His goodness in the end times. I believe that as an end times preacher, God wants us to come to His goodness. But He's preparing a banqueting table for us to eat. He's inviting us to dine. And what do? We sit and study in our heads. We think and we read and yet never come to a glorious knowledge of dining with Him and what it means to dine with you. I don't know about you, but I'm going on a divine diet. I'm going to start letting God dictate to me any appetites that are not sinful in and of themselves, but are a distraction or a detour from a further hungering and thirsting after Him. So, Father, right now, we call for a fast in this church, not just of food, but a fast of detours, appetites, relationships, activities that are basically functioning to draw us away from the fountain. From the fountain and the tree of life within that draws us away from proper times of feeding. I can still remember that young man who was so hungry for God, but when he would honk the horn for me to leave to get in the car and Mike in that carpool, it was like, oh, I'm like attached to God and I'm pulling away, until God taught me, you don't ever leave me. Prayer is not going in and out of something. Prayer is being with me. And I learned to carry Him with me. Even though that private time is special, you're supposed to carry with Him 24/7. So Father, we're gonna go on a hunger strike. we're going to strike out to feast and dine with the Lord. He's invited us. He's invited all the churches, come and dine. I want the hidden manna. I'm not even satisfied until I find a hidden manna. And whatever it takes to bring me to that place of vulnerability to tap into that hidden manna, so be it, God. Deal with me accordingly. I want a divine diet in the name of the Lord. And I want these substitutes to be identified and removed. Even if they're not sinful in and of themselves, they're not you, and I want you. That I might know you, that I might progressively become more intimately acquainted with all the wonders of your personhood, those attributes to feed and to drink instead of reading and thinking alone. In Jesus' name, amen.
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit forgive123.com.